Hi, Felipe here from the Data Science Bits channel. I want to explain to you today the data science pipeline, or you may call it a data science workflow. I will be explaining each different instance in the pipeline. This video will serve as a basis for many other videos that I intend to shoot in this channel, and in special the feature engineering series. And these feature engineering videos will be about 20 videos or more just about this topic. So it's really important that you understand what is feature engineering and where it happens in the data science pipeline. So before we dive into this whole pipeline, there are three different instances where you use this pipeline for. The first one is supervised regression. So you have numbers that you want to predict, such as the price of a product, and you already have a set where you know the price, and based on the characteristics of the products, you will predict prices. Another way is when you have labels instead of numbers. And when you have labels, you do the same. You predict the groups or the types of products based on the characteristics. Then the third type is unsupervised learning. And you are usually doing this with clustering algorithms. You don't have any label, but you have the characteristics of the population or the items or the companies or anything that you want to classify. There are other types of machine learning algorithms that are, for example, self-supervising algorithms. This may go through a different type of pipeline that I'm not discussing here. So let's go to the chart that shows all these different instances in the pipeline, and let's discuss it item by item. The pipeline starts with data, of course, and the data must come from somewhere. So in many cases, it would be a data engineer or a data engineering team making this data available to the data scientists. Or maybe the data scientist himself or herself will be calling data from an external API. It really depends on the project. So I will not stick with one possibility here. It's very flexible. And what matters is that data is made available somehow in the beginning of the pipeline. And the second step is a very important step that's called data splitting. You basically split your data set between training, validation, and test. The idea is that the training set you will only use to train your model is where your model is learning from. And the model in the training phase must not have access to validation and test. The third step is pre-processing. And many times pre-processing is confused with feature engineering, but it's not true. Pre-processing can be thought as something that's standalone, and it's basically cleansing and normalization. And these tasks are much simpler than feature engineering. It usually will involve getting rid of characters that are not relevant, that are not alphanumerical, for example. This is a type of cleansing. Normalization could be, for example, if you have different addresses, you want an address to have a very specific format, a very specific order, and very specific acronyms too, or abbreviations. And now we reached what's for me the most important step in the data science pipeline, the data science workflow, is the feature engineering. And as I said, I will make a full series of videos just on feature engineering, and I'm planning more than 20 videos that I will prepare just for you to be aware of every detail on feature engineering. I already discussed missing data treatment somewhere else in other videos. I'm making available on the top of the video, and also will make available as cards in the end of the video. There are also other things like combinations of different features can make new features. Aggregations of information that you have in your original data set can be new features. Transformations, encodings. And you can see all these types of feature engineering as something that you do to achieve what I call rectangular data. What's rectangular data? It's here in the bottom, you have rows that are IDs. So for example, if you are dealing with persons, it's the ID of each person. If you are dealing with companies, it's the ID of each company, or IDs of each product. Or maybe it could be the ID plus a date, if you are talking about time series. And what's important here is actually that each row is a different entity, or it could be the same entity in different dates, for example. And the columns will be features. And the features sometimes are called variables. And as I said, whatever we are doing here in the feature engineering phase is exactly to make the data set look like this. The next step is called labeling, and it's only when you don't have labels available, but you need them or you desire them in order to train supervised models. You don't have these things available, but you think that your model will be better if it's supervised, and or you have resources in order to do that. There are two ways to approach this, the manual method or the rule-based method. On the manual method, you are going to do this really manually, yourself, other people in your company, or maybe you are outsourcing this work to other people. And you are going to make simple rules and provide some examples to these people so they can do this by themselves. And in the end, you will have a reasonable amount of data to train your model. And usually you would like to have a voting system where three different people try to classify each instance. The other method, that's the rule-based method, is very simple. You just make some functions, for example, in Python, that will, based on simple rules, so basically if-else statements, decide what's the class. This is not perfect at all. And usually you will make a first run with labels like that, and maybe we will learn something from the experience and from the way the model is behaving. And later we will tweak this a bit to get better performance. The next step is the exploratory data analysis, or many people call it EDA. You will hear this a lot. The exploratory data analysis actually can come earlier in the pipeline. I'm putting it here just for simplicity because I like to do my EDA after I have the features built, or at least some basic features built. But it can come at the same time as the feature engineering, for example. The EDA can guide you in the feature engineering phase too. So it's very hard to separate them, but I prefer just to be very clear here to position it after feature engineering and after labeling, because it's very useful to do EDA when you have your features in hand and when you have the labels in hand to make decisions based on the training set. And now finally the model development. But you may ask why model development should be the most important part, right? We are doing data science because of machine learning. That's not true. Model development is a small portion of this. Of course, depending on the position you hold, the job that you have, you may be very focused on model development, but this on the vast majority of cases for data scientists is not true. The data science work goes from the beginning of this pipeline to the end of this pipeline. The next step is the performance monitoring. Much more important than spending a lot of time on model development is to spend a lot of time on performance monitoring. And in this phase, you are going to print out reports, print out plots, that make it very clear what's the performance of our model. And it's not only that, you don't need to print all available metrics. This is being really stupid, actually. You need to print out the performance metrics that are relevant for the business problem you are tackling. And to understand this, you cannot be a data scientist that's completely isolated from business. You need to understand what really moves the needle in your market, in your niche. And this is really important. This is really where many data scientists will fail. Now, the next step is interpretation. Performance monitoring and interpretation, let's be honest, they go together, but I prefer again to split them here in different steps. Interpretation is really important for business and to understand what's happening. There are many ways to approach this. There are global interpretations and there are local interpretations. Now we reached the iteration step. This step means that basically you can go back on the green arrow and you can start modifying it in order to get better performance. Now we reach the deployment phase. People call it also to put it in production, basically. And there are many different possibilities in this phase. It really depends on the systems, on the cloud, It depends on how the company desires to use the model that you built. The truth is that the deployment phase, if you haven't done the other steps in a more or less automated way, you will suffer a lot to deploy it. So it's a good practice to go through the pre-processing, feature engineering, labeling, exploratory data analysis, model development, performance monitoring, and interpretation. Doing all your code in an organized way, documenting it, and also making it modularized enough so you can deploy it easily. And there's a feedback loop, and this is not always that it happens, but you could be getting new answers, new classifications, new numbers from the users that are using your model or the companies that are using your model in the system. And you can use this to train your model again or to increase your training set or to increase also your validation set. And usually this will help you to keep your model up to date. And if you have a feedback loop phase, it's really, really, really important to have a very automated performance monitoring step that will print out logs and will be really easy to access. So that's it. I think the video was longer than what I thought initially, but it's really interesting to go step by step in this chart and understand what's happening and what are the possibilities. I plan to make videos on all these different steps, and especially the feature engineering series that's upcoming. See you in the next video. Subscribe to the YouTube channel, follow me on LinkedIn, and also don't miss the new videos on feature engineering that I'm going to prepare. It will be awesome.